pray together. Oh God, we are so grateful for your grace, for your marvelous grace. And I pray that this morning, out of your grace and your mercy, you would send your Holy Spirit. Not because I am worthy or any of us are, but because Jesus is. And I pray that you would come here amongst us, that you'd step on our toes, that you'd touch our hearts, that you'd point our eyes to Jesus. We pray this in his name. Amen. On May 24, 1626, perhaps the most infamous trade of all history took place. Pieter Minuit of the Dutch East India Company traded some kettles and cloth and axe heads and awls, some mouth harps, some wampum for the island of Manhattan. He traded those goods with a band of the Metoic, most likely the Canarsie, who didn't have any concept of permanent property ownership. They most likely thought that they were trading for the ability of the Dutch East India Company to share their hunting grounds or to pass through, but they had no idea that they were giving up the island itself for what would be, in about today's purchasing power, $600. Now, if you were to go today to Manhattan, there are many hotels where $600 would not buy you one night stay. And yet the entire island was purchased rather dubiously for that value. And yet I believe there have been some trades in history that are far worse. That the price certainly isn't right. This morning I want to base our time of study on a familiar story, Genesis 25. If you'll turn with me there in your Bible. Genesis 25, we're going to look at verses 27 through 34. It's a familiar story. Story of Jacob and Esau. Jacob and Esau were children of Isaac, the son of Abraham, whom God had promised to bless him that he might be a blessing to the nations. Picking up in verse 27, if you're there, you can say amen. So the boys grew, and Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, but Jacob was a mild man, dwelling in tents. And Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. So Esau is a daddy's boy. Jacob is a mama's boy. Now Jacob cooked a stew, and Esau came in from the field, and he was weary. And Esau said to Jacob, "Please feed me with that same red stew, for I am weary." Therefore, his name was called Edom, which means red. But Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright as of this day." And Esau said, "Look, I'm about to die, so what is this birthright to me?" Then Jacob said, "Swear to me as of this day." So he swore to him, and sold his birthright to Jacob. And Jacob gave Esau bread and stew of lentils. Then he ate and drank and arose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Now, my wife makes some amazing red lentil curry. And you put that with some naan, you know, some Indian flatbread, and it's good stuff. But I don't know how much I would be willing to trade for that. I mean, his birthright? That's double the inheritance. That's the spiritual leadership of the family. That's the blessing of God upon you and your descendants and your descendants' descendants for a bowl of stew, a bowl of lentils. Most of us read this story and think, Esau, how could you be so stupid? I would never do anything like that. But the truth is, you do it all the time. We as humans do it all the time. And you too probably would be willing to sell your birthright for the right bowl of lentils. You just might be willing to give up your marriage, your family, your career, your relationship with God for the right bowl of lentils. Statistics tell us that 2/3 of women and 3/4 of men say that they would cheat on their spouse if they knew they wouldn't get caught. The right bowl of lentils. This morning, what I want to talk with you about is something that is universal to our human experience, and that's appetites. Now, when we think of that word, appetites, we think of hunger for food, like the story here with Jacob and Esau. But appetites are so much more than a hunger or a desire for food. Appetites include a desire for a whole range of things. It includes a sexual desire, a desire for freedom from pain, desire for acceptance and belonging, desire for success and accomplishment, the desire for happiness. All these are appetites, which, by the way, are God-given desires. God has created us for a longing for these things, but sin has taken these desires and twisted them, and turned them back on us, and perverted them in order to cause our ruin. Now, some of you might say, Reed, appetites, I mean, is that really worth talking about? Is that really worth preaching a whole sermon on? I just want you to think in your mind and start making a list of people that you know whose lives and careers and marriages and families and walks with the Lord have been ruined because of their appetite. We could spend the rest of our time listing off politicians and celebrities, pastors, friends, neighbors, church members who have shipwrecked their lives and sidelined themselves because of their appetites. And you and I, we face the same temptation. I think that often we underestimate the power of appetite. But many of you have had experiences where you have a spiritual high. You're on a mountaintop. Maybe it's a week of prayer or a conference or a sermon or a book. And then you go home and that same appetite is waiting and lurking and ready to pounce. And you find yourself in the exact same place you've been 1,000 times before. And that spiritual high wasn't enough to deliver you from the power of appetite. You see, sin has taken our appetites and perverted them in two key ways. I just want to talk with you this morning about these ways. The first way is that sin has taken our appetites and attached to them this idea of more. Whispers in our ear, yells in our ear at times, more, 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 more. Proverbs 27:20 says, "Hell and destruction are never full." So the eyes of man are never satisfied. Now just think about this. Satan's appetite for your ruin, the appetite of hell and destruction, are never satisfied. Never satisfied. And connected to that same idea is that the appetite in your own heart is never satisfied. The eyes of a man are never satisfied. Think about this. King David. How many wives and concubines did he have? But were they enough? Were his eyes satisfied? He looks out and he sees Bathsheba. And he doesn't turn away and say, "I have enough, I'm satisfied." His appetite, through the voice of sin and Satan, is whispering in his ear, more, 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 more. And it's not just lust. Ecclesiastes 5, verse 10. "He who loves silver will not be satisfied with silver, nor he who loves abundance with increase. This also is vanity." The desire for wealth. Our appetite tells us more, 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 more. You know what the average work week for a billionaire is? Now think about it. Billionaire. That's 1,000 million. If you had $1 billion, how much would you want to work? The average work week for a billionaire today is 50 to 60 plus hours. Why? Because their appetites say more, 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 more. John D. Rockefeller was once asked, "How much is enough?" This is a man at that time who was one of the richest in the world. And his reply, "Just a little more." It's not just lust. It's not just money. It's even our desire for food. "All the labor of man is for his mouth, and yet the soul is not satisfied." You've done it before. You've pulled up to the Thanksgiving table and you sat there and you ate more and more and more and more until you couldn't eat anymore. And then 3 or 4 hours later, you're back to the table where the leftovers are, right? Because our appetites are never fully and finally satisfied. Now notice this. Solomon here is not just talking about the desire for women or money or food. He's saying a man labors all the life for his mouth, yet his soul is not satisfied. And if there's any person on this planet who had the opportunity to test whether more would ever be enough, it was Solomon. Story is there in Ecclesiastes. He said, I had women and wealth and servants and pleasure beyond measure, but my soul was not satisfied. You see, our appetites whisper in our ear, more, 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 but more is never enough. There's not enough women in the world, or men in the world. There are not enough images on the screen or drinks at the bar. There's not enough food at the grocery store. There's not enough success or wealth to satisfy you. And if there's not enough in this world to satisfy the longing of our hearts and souls, could it be, perhaps, that we should look somewhere else? That we should look beyond this world for something that can truly satisfy us? The psalmist says this, "Oh, that men would give thanks to the Lord, for He satisfies the longing soul. And He fills the soul, the hungry soul, with goodness." Brothers and sisters, it is God alone who can bring you satisfaction in your heart and your soul, and you will not find that satisfaction anywhere else on this planet. But Satan will whisper in your ear, and you will whisper through your appetites, that if you could just have a little more, and a little more, and a little more, then one day you'll be satisfied. But it's a lie. More is never enough. More is never enough. Your appetites will never be fully and finally satisfied apart from God. So Satan causes our appetites to whisper to us more, to tell us, to shout to us more. And he also causes our appetites to whisper and shout to us now. More, now, now. You see, to our appetites, the idea of waiting is death. Esau comes in. He's hungry. Maybe he has been without food for a day or two. And he says, "What's my birthright to me if I die here waiting to cook my own food? I have to have it right now." And your appetites and my appetites tell me the exact same thing. Right now is when you need it and when you want it. 2 Corinthians 4:18 tells us that the Christian has a very different perspective than the now, the instant gratification perspective. Paul says, "We do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal." But your appetites will distort your perspective and cause you not to look down the road 10 minutes, or 10 weeks, or 10 months, or 10 years. They will cause you to only look at right now. They will cause you to trade the ultimate for the immediate. And the Bible says that price is wrong. Because the immediate, the seen, is temporary. It's going to be gone, and what you can't see is eternal. This is why Scripture tells us to walk by faith and not by sight. Because what we experience with our senses is only temporary, and what we cannot see is eternal. This is why Jesus says, what profit is it for a man if he gains the whole world but loses his soul? You can gain the whole world, but you're only going to have it for a few minutes. And then you're going to have lost eternity. Satan whispers to us through our appetites now. The Bible tells us God has put eternity in our hearts to look not at the now, but at the ultimate. 1 John 2. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Our appetites tell us more, and they tell us now. They tell us to trade the ultimate for the immediate. Now, I just want you to think about Esau. And think about what he was trading for that bowl of lentils. The birthright, at that time, in that culture, there was nothing greater. There was no greater possession of value and worth than the birthright. It meant double the inheritance. Twice as much land and wealth and prosperity as Jacob would get. It meant the spiritual leadership of the family, that he would be the head of the family. And it meant the blessings of God for generations and generations to come. Now, throughout Scripture, there's a formula that subsequent generations after Esau used to talk of their God, to remind them of how great God is. They would say the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Esau. That's what it was supposed to be. He was the firstborn. The birthright was his. It was supposed to be the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Esau. And in the book of Matthew, when they're talking about the genealogy of the Savior, it was supposed to be that Jesus was a descendant of Abraham and of Isaac and of Esau. And Esau traded that for a bowl of lentils. If only he could have seen the ultimate that he was giving up for the immediate. But his appetite said more, and it said now, and he missed out on God's plan and God's blessing in his life. And when your appetites and my appetites come knocking on my door, knocking on your door, they will lie and weasel and connive you in any way they can to keep you from looking down the road. What's going to happen if you eat this? What's going to happen if you talk to her or look at that? What's going to happen if you accept this promotion or this offer? They will cause you to not look down the road, not consider the cost, not count the consequences, but to look at the here and now and say that that is the only thing that matters. Don't worry about the ultimate. Don't worry about the full and the final cost. More and now. But brothers and sisters, the price isn't right. We're trading the eternal for the temporary. We're ruining our lives and our health and our families. And Satan and the appetite of hell and destruction are rejoicing. You see, God, it's not that he doesn't want us to have pleasure. It's not that he doesn't want us to be happy and to be satisfied. It's just that he has eternal vision. And he sees down the road. He knows the results of when we say yes. And because he wants our happiness, because he wants us to be eternally satisfied, and he knows that can only be in him, he warns us
more now
about the danger of appetite.
More.
Do you know what a vice is?
More.
What's a vice?
More. More.
Oh, come on, don't be shy.
More.
What's a vice?
More. More.
Something that holds something in place. V-I-S-E.
More.
But what else is a vice?
More. More.
It's a sin, right?
More.
But it's got a hold of you, and it's got a grip upon you.
More.
And see, God knows that every time we say yes,
more. More.
Our vice
now
grips us more tightly and becomes a vice.
More. Now. More.
Yes.
Now. More. Now.
Yes.
More. Now. It's okay. More. God wants you to be happy. More.
Yes.
Now. More. Now. More. More. Now.
Yes.
More. Now.
Yes.
More. Now.
Yes.
It's okay. It's not going to hurt. God wants you to be happy.
Okay.
More. Now.
Yes.
More. God will forgive you later.
Yes.
More. Now.
Yes.
More. Now.
Yes.
One, you've gone so far now. One more won't hurt you that bad.
Yes.
Now. More. Now.
Yes.
More. Now.
Yes.
My pleasure. More. More. Now.
Yes.
More. More now.
Yeah.
More. More. You could take a little more. You'll be fine. Nobody's watching. More. More now.
Oh God. I need some
more.
God.
More now. More.
No.
No. More. More.
No.
Just a little more.
No.
More.
No.
Just a little.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
I'll be here to help you whenever
you... More.
Thank you.
I'll see you in a little bit.
Every time we say yes to our vices, they become a vice. And they grip us tighter and tighter and tighter, and they won't stop till they've got us fully and finally. We know from brain science that what we're actually doing every time we say yes is we're actually rewiring the hardware in our brain to say yes again the next time, quicker and more easily. And every time we say no, we're also changing that hardware and that wiring, so that the next time we can say no louder and more firmly. You see, God in His vision knows what's at the end of the path. And when He tells us to not go down there, it's not because He's a grumpy, stingy old man. It's because He's a compassionate Father who knows the end result upon you and your family, upon your children and your grandchildren, upon this world and His kingdom. And He longs for you to say yes to Him and no to your vice. Now you might say, well, that's fine and good advice from God, but what does He know about not having the things that He wants and desires? After all, He's up in heaven. He's got all He wants. Nothing affects Him or touches Him. And brothers and sisters, it's simply not true. The Jesus of the Gospels is God who stepped down into our shoes to know our temptations and to know our struggles. I invite you to turn with me to Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. I want to look at this and one more text with you this morning. About how we may experience deliverance. For by the way, Once you are in the grip of vice, don't think you can get out on your own. Ever. It will grip you and hold you tight and bring you down. And unless you have some help from God and from God's people, it will keep yelling in your ear more and more and now until it has taken everything. Matthew 4. When I planned this sermon, I didn't know that this would be one of the topics of the Sabbath school this morning. Matthew 4, verses 1 through 4. If you're there, you can say amen. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And just pause there for a second. Notice who he was led by? The Spirit. And what was the purpose of him being led, according to Matthew? To be tempted. Now, Jesus taught us in the Lord's Prayer to pray, Lord, lead me not into temptation. And I believe that God does not lead us into temptation. But you see, it was God's plan and his purpose for Jesus Christ to experience every single kind of temptation that you and I experience, and to an even greater degree. So to fulfill his mission, Jesus had to be led in order to be tempted. And when he had fasted, how many days? 40 days and 40 nights. Afterward, he was hungry. Now, I would say that that's a bit of an understatement. If I skip lunch, I'm hungry. Blood sugar drops. Get irritable. After 40 days, he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. 40 days he was fasting. And every single moment during those 40 days, he could have snapped his finger and the rocks would have been bread and he would have had food. And here, Lucifer comes, Satan comes, and pushes that point home. If you are the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Brothers and sisters, do you realize how ridiculous it is to think that Jesus doesn't know what it's like to be tempted? When we're struggling at midnight whether or not to eat that cake, we've had a full dinner. Do you think Jesus knows what it's like to face temptation? 40 days. And his appetite was gnawing at him. And he looked Satan square in the eyes and said, no. He answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Brothers and sisters, Jesus knows what it's like. Esau had been hungry for maybe a day, maybe two, and he gave up his birthright. Jesus had been fasting for 40 days. And at just the same point where Eve gave it all up, and Esau sold himself out, Jesus won the victory. He knows what it's like to be in your shoes, even more than you know what it's like to be in your shoes. He has experienced every type of temptation that you and I could ever possibly go through. Hebrews 4, our last verse for today. Hebrews 4. Turn with me there. Verses 15 to 16. When you get there, you can say amen. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Brothers and sisters, Jesus knows. He's experienced it. He's walked in your shoes, and he was victorious. And he invites us to come boldly to his throne of grace. So what's your bowl of lentils? What is the temptation in your life that whispers and speaks and shouts in your ear, more, more, now, now? What is your bowl of lentils that causes your vision to be distorted and for you to be willing to trade everything just to get a little more? Is it some images on a screen? A girl, boy, man or a woman? Is it a substance or a food? Is it success or wealth or belonging? What is your bowl of lentils? And some of you haven't just been staring at that bowl of lentils. You've already eaten it. Others might not know, but you already made trade. Your spouse doesn't know. Your parents don't know. But she said yes. Brothers and sisters, we can come boldly to the throne of grace to find mercy and help in our time of need. But please, don't let it consume you. For your sake, for your family's sake, for God's sake, call upon the name of Jesus. Call upon a brother or a sister or a pastor in the church. Let God, let his people help you. Because there's grace and there's mercy to help us here and now. This morning, this afternoon, I'd like to invite you to sing with me the closing hymn, I'd Rather Have Jesus, number 327. And I'm going to ask you to stand as we sing this. And as we sing this, I'm going to ask you to surrender your bowl of lentils, that thing, that appetite, to the Lord. And if that's your desire, if that's what you want, the commitment you want to make today, I'm going to simply invite you to come down here to the front. It's not a proclamation of what it is, but it's simply saying, Jesus, I'm calling upon your name, and I'm surrendering myself to you. As we sing, if that's your desire this morning, today, come down to the front.
Spirit needs, I'd rather. tears and let him lead, than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's grand sway. Rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Dear Jesus, we know that you would rather have us. You chose us before this world began. You chose us in the wilderness. You chose us in the garden. You chose us on the cross. And you said you'd rather have us than anything, even your own life. Jesus, you're fairer than the lilies. You're all that we desire and that we need. So we want to call upon you and ask that you would help us to choose you, to come to your throne of grace, even with boldness. Know that we will find mercy and help in time of need. Oh God, we need your help. We need the help of the people around us. So Lord God, set us free. There are some here who have been bound, who've been in the grip of vice for a long time. God, I pray that you would set them free. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for who you are. In your name, amen.